Good morning. Sailor Hardware, may I help you?
This is Agent 4587, day code, style section, 11087, ident procedure, the fashion factory.
Hey, how you doing, Vinny? Welcome to life with the lifeguard. How was the house of many doors?
Terrible. Even the Christmas pageant stunk.
Tonight on Animal House Radio, we're bringing you a very rare interview. We are joined tonight by iconic actor Ken Wahl from the movie The Wanderers and the hit television series Wiseguy. Joining Ken Wahl tonight is a very special guest, my pal Tony Ganios from the movies The Wanderers and Porky's. It's a Wiseguy and Wanderers reunion, and it all happens right here, right now on Animal House Radio.
Stations are tuned in to
5, 4, 3, 3, 2, 1, 1, 1, 1. We have ignition. Strap in.
You're about to listen to
The Animal House.
You're nothing but an animal.
Your mother's an animal.
Show your food, you're an animal.
Keep the change, you filthy animal.
They're animals anyway, so let them lose their souls.
We are all animals, my lady.
I'm not an animal!
What do you care? You're an animal. You're an animal.
Yeah.
I'm an animal!
Yeah.
All aboard!
Atomic batteries to power. Turbines to speed.
I feel the need for speed.
The opinions expressed by the hosts, callers, and guests are not those of Animal House Radio. Some of the material broadcast on Animal House Radio may not be suitable for listeners under the age of 18. Listener discretion is advised.
Hello, this is Kelsey Grammer.
Hi, this is Katie Segal.
Hi, this is Joe Elliott.
Hey, it's Rick Springfield.
Hey, this is Tommy Chung.
Hi, this is Carol Burdett.
Hey, this is Larry the Cable Guy, and you're listening to the Animal House Radio Show. And if you're not, you're a communist. Get it done.
All right, everybody, we're here. It's Wednesday. It's time for the Animal House Radio Show.
Yeah, baby.
Coming to you live from the Theodore Jiggett Studios.
Welcome to the jungle! Yeah!
We took the week off last week, and, you know.
We did?
Yes.
I was here.
Oh, you were?
Are we at Gilbert Godfrey's show? I just heard the Sam Kinison.
Yeah.
Are we at my show tonight?
Yeah, right? The ghost of Sam Kinison is haunting us tonight, but we got a great show for you lined up. We put a lot of work into this show, and...
You did. We didn't.
No, well, we all...
No, I didn't do anything.
I
had to drive here.
I've been trying to get this guy on for a couple of months, and he's semi-retired, and, well, he's retired. He's not
They've
in the business anymore.
Me.
But he's graciously granted us an interview, and it's very rare that he does interviews nowadays, so we're honored to have him on. Joining us in the 9 o'clock hour is iconic actor and TV star Ken Wahl.
Yes.
Yeah.
Woo! Yes,
absolutely. From Wiseguy.
Yes, and joining him together, it's going to be like a Wanderers reunion tonight. Wanderers and Wiseguy reunion.
Mm-hmm.
Joining us is our friend who we've had on previously, my good friend Tony Ganios, who
yes.
you remember from Porky's.
Meat.
Meat, yes, right. And Wiseguy, he played Mooch.
That's right.
So Mooch and Meat.
And you know what's good when you're semi-retired? Means you drive halfway to work, then you come home.
Yeah,
that's right.
Or you drive halfway home, then go back.
Yeah.
You could do that too.
Shay does it every day.
I'm always driving halfway.
If I missed a bus on this, I'm sorry. I wanted to
I missed the bus. He missed the bus.
We missed the bus. They all missed the bus.
I'm the bus.
Anti-Meridian.
Everybody on the bus.
All the
little
Meridians.
Meridians.
Magna Carta, Master Charger, Visa Carta.
I wanted to do a belated birthday to Dave, who just had a birthday.
Dave who?
Over the...
When?
I don't know if I celebrated it. I don't know if I mentioned it.
No, you don't give a damn about
When was yours? When was your birthday?
Last month. Look, Dave, the first step is acceptance. Now the healing can begin.
Yes.
You were October?
Yeah. Yes.
October
yeah.
what?
20th.
Oh, yeah. Very good.
So I'm sorry I missed that.
If You're
I
on the cusp.
I could have swore I said something, but if I didn't.
It's
and
okay.
And over the weekend, where Mr. Giselle Veneer celebrated his birthday.
Yeah.
So.
Hello, Paul.
I had to drive home from all the way home from the Utica area, Rochester area of New York, with a bad transmission.
Well, I'm getting
nice. 370 miles. It was very nice.
Do you still have your van?
No, well.
The Astro van?
Wait, hold on. I'm getting to that. I'm building up to that.
Oh, he's building up to that.
Ever since they won the World Series.
We've had a death in the Animal House Radio family.
Uh-oh.
Unfortunately, Paul's Astro van is no longer with us.
Oh, no, I still have it. I drove it to your house. It drives. I just can't take it far.
It didn't die yet.
He can't go to the 7-Eleven or else
you
the
just
whole...
can't kill this thing. It's a machine.
Yes. Yeah.
He's it's like Christine.
It's like, it is. I swear to God, it is.
But it never goes out of third gear. It goes...
Paul
and
stands up in front of says, show
he's
me.
Like, he's
look,
saying,
he's bleeding. He's still a man.
He's making it sound like he's got a flat tire. The guy goes, you lost your motor mounts. It's sitting right on the differential. Like, the thing is going to just, like...
So you're lucky you made home alive, he said. Oh, thank you very much. I feel good. I feel better.
All right,
I feel blessed.
Oh, thank God, because I got to show him Boston next week.
Paul, when this happened, were you Maryland. In the middle of a highway?
Was that?
You were in the middle of the highway when this all started?
No, in his lane.
He drives on the sidewalk.
No, I was
right in the lane, not on the
I was 160 miles away from going to where I was going.
Oh, wow.
So I had to go another 160 miles and so then 370 miles
so
home.
So you were like halfway there.
Just about that, yeah. About how, yeah, a little bit less
than
halfway. Where
did you have to go, Albany?
No, I was up near Rochester, Canandaigua. It's up near Rochester area.
Oh, wow. All right.
It's pretty far. Yeah. 370 miles.
That's right by Sodus Point.
Canandaigua, that's Spanish, right?
Canandaigua?
Yeah.
Canandaigua.
So it's a
south part
of Canada. Give me two cans. I want two cans of Dega.
Yeah.
Tell that story, Paul.
Two cans.
So I have to drive home, and I find out when I go, I bring it to my friend who does transmissions. He's a really honest guy. He doesn't cheat you or anything. He goes, okay, you can put $2,100 into this and get a new transmission. He said, but your van's going to fall apart anytime anyway because the motor mounts are gone. Right. He said, the engine's sitting on the differential, he said. The rocker arms are gone. He said, everything's going. You're lucky the whole engine didn't fall out of the thing on the way home.
Basically, he said, you could put $2,100 into it, but it's only worth $21.
Exactly. Yeah. Basically, yes.
You know, take a couple zeros off, and
he
that's
said,
what you
he said, I'm not going to tell you what to do. He said, I already know what I'm not going to do. I'm buying another van. I ain't using this one anymore.
Yeah.
I already know what I'm doing. I'm not putting money into that
thing.
You
know what you do? Put it in the backyard. Use it as a shed.
I already have a shed.
Front yard is a front shed.
This is a movable shed.
A playground.
No, Paul's going to use it as a mausoleum.
Yeah. I want to make a planter out of it.
Here lies the tornado. Yeah. He's going to be in the back next to the JBL speakers that are all blown out and stuff.
and the old cases?
The old cases. Duct tape. All my duct tape.
Duct tape.
I can fix that with duct tape.
Sounds like Ed's van.
Wait a minute.
I fix that transmission with duct tape.
I only had a van.
Correct me if I'm wrong, Paul. Don't they call the musician cases coffins?
No.
Is there some cases that they...
Anvil cases. They call them anvil cases.
I could have sworn they called them coffin cases.
I never called them a coffin case. I never heard that expression.
I don't know. Maybe
everybody has their own expression, probably, but they're anvil. They're anvil cases, calzone cases. They're all different kinds. But,
now, Paul, when Ed buys the van from you, does the duct tape go with it? Or
Just one roll.
That's good enough. That's a starter kit.
You see Paul out there going, motor mounts? Who needs them? Go another 400,000 miles.
He's not wasting duct tape on that.
Flat
no
tire. I got the flex seal for that.
Fix the flat. You could spray the bottom of this canoe.
So anyway, Gene goes out before the show. Ed's show is on, and he goes out and picks up Daisy or
Daisy.
Hibiscus.
Which one's Daisy?
Hibiscus, Daisy.
Daphne.
Daphne.
DJ Fluffy.
D. Yeah.
DJ Fluffy.
DJ Fluffy.
Danny D.
So they go to get something to eat, and they come back, and they offer everybody food, which is awesome.
Except
so
me.
I was over there talking
no,
to
they
Gene.
No, they offered it to you.
They offered it to you. There's just none left.
No.
You slobs.
So I walk over to Gene. I was talking to him. So I come back, and I didn't realize where they had the food situated. So I looked inside of a bag, and this one, Daisy, took out her fucking claws and go, that smile like fucking Wolverine, and swung at me. I'm like, holy shit. Gene, what do you do, starve these kids?
They only get to eat once every other day. That's it.
I thought I was like Harvey Weinstein or something. She was coming at me like,
look at her. The poor girl can't even afford shoes. She had to trade her shoes for tacos.
Yeah. Every other day she's calling Gene up, can you bring me home a chicken salad sandwich?
And Gene said, fuck you, you kids eat tomorrow.
You kids eat tomorrow.
It's not the third
Is it Thursday yet?
Yeah, it's not the third Wednesday of the month. And don't even think about bathing.
Who do you think you are, Bank of America?
Yeah.
She asked for a chicken sandwich, and Gene said, put the lotion in the fucking bucket.
It puts the lotion in the bag.
Army crawl. Army crawl.
Or it gets the hose again.
And then it gets a $1,000 bill for peeing.
Army crawl to the refrigerator.
Yeah. Army crawl. Get down. Down.
You guys are killing me, man. I don't know what to do. Hey, this is Doc G with a live update.
I'm here with Dunkin' Donuts.
I got one lung left. My house is falling apart.
These kids want to eat again.
We already ate this week. What are you talking about?
I bet Gene's kids were like 6 years old before they found out there was no such thing as Alpo baby food.
Hey, Chris. Hey, kids. Let's open up the Christmas presents. Look, Cheerios. Yay.
Dad, it says Alpo on it. No, that's Meat Helper.
No, it's
that's Hamburger for Mommy. Helper. That's look for Mommy.
That's the chef's name.
I have
that's
a can of name. Nine lives.
Chef Boyard Alpo.
Grandma's Mystery Appetite.
But if you get the right one, it's like stew because they have the carrots and stuff in it. So
he has to tell the kids, no, the dog food's for Mommy, kids. You.
All right, Gene, we're sorry.
What the hell?
Say hi to Jack Jambanko.
That was a Black Op helicopter.
Lights.
Jack Jambanko, big Jack? Shout out. Great product, and I encourage everybody to pick one up because we all need a little
What
more.
If we don't have friends?
Then you make friends. That's the whole
you make
point.
Friendship
lights. Shine the light at people. Blind them.
Blind them in their eyes.
And then you know, rescue them after that. After they're blind, say, "Look, I'm your friend. You can see me now."
So,
noob.
I had to ask a question.
Noob.
And we'll go around the room. Joining us in the 9 o'clock will be Ken Wahl from the TV show Wiseguy and the movie The Wanderers. It's a rare interview, and we're pleased to have him on the show tonight.
No, it's not rare. We interview people all the time.
Now, we didn't do a... Yeah, well...
Not last week.
No, we did. I did. I was here. I don't know where the fuck you people were. I thought you were all in the bathroom.
So we didn't really do a Halloween show, and I apologize. That's my fault. I dropped the ball.
It wasn't really Halloween.
How old is too old to stop trick-or-treating?
Never.
In your opinion? No, never. In all seriousness?
Never.
It depends if you have a sweet tooth or not.
Never. Do you enjoy it?
No, if a 30-year-old guy came to your door, you would give him candy?
Well, if he's wearing a disguise, you wouldn't know he's 30 years old.
I don't give anybody candy. I don't hand out candy.
What if he's disguised as a little kid?
Right,
a six-year-old.
Exactly. Right. Well, then he's part
pretty
of
damn
that.
Good in my book, is what he is.
No, I mean,
if you want candy that bad, you can have it.
No, you know what? It's not. I don't even think it's for the candy.
Would you encourage your kids at 15 or 16 to still go out and trick or treat?
Yeah. Yeah.
15 or 16. Yeah. 15,
have you
yeah.
seen that's the fine. Pictures on Facebook? Would I encourage my kids? I was just as Wonder Woman last year or 2 years ago. Last year.
Yeah, but it's different than if you're going to a costume
and then
party
I was Dorothy.
As an adult.
He wasn't going to a costume party.
I went trick-or-treating.
Oh, you did? Okay. Well, then your answer would be?
You're never too old.
111.
Okay. That's what I said.
Ed, what about you?
It's not about the candy.
Ed doesn't celebrate birthdays, so I'm pretty sure he's not into trick-or-treating.
It's about getting away with
well,
wearing high
Halloween.
Heels in your neighborhood.
Yeah, free candy. I'm in.
No, how old would you think is too old to do?
You know.
I know after 11, you're not supposed to celebrate birthdays.
Yeah, after 11, you stop celebrating birthdays.
Oh, bullshit.
Yeah, no, I celebrate birthdays.
Yeah, keep celebrating birthdays because, you know,
December
16th,
I'm going
out. Hey, it's the only way I remember how to count.
Yeah.
Why? What are you going to know how to count for?
Well, what do you have an age or you don't really believe there is?
I honestly don't remember. My kids trick-or-treated till they just didn't want to trick-or-treat anymore.
Right.
What about you? You personally, same thing?
I'll be honest, probably about 10, I don't remember.
Yeah, you lost interest early.
Yeah, we were in Newark. You know, we were more worried about getting shot at than we were about...
It wasn't as bad as... But see, no. They poison everybody with the... They make everybody so paranoid to go out and do it. I don't see the turnout like when the kids used to be flooded.
I had seven kids this year. Seven, that's it.
Well, you know what the difference is too, though, Carlo.
What?
Nowadays they have a lot of the schools. They do the trunk or treat,
and
that way you don't have kids going throughout the neighborhood. Everybody's there; it's controlled. All the parents are there, and it makes it a lot easier.
You know what? I did that with my daughter this year, and I got to tell you, these people because you're supposed to decorate your trunk, and then bring a bowl of candy. And so I pulled my car in, and I opened the trunk, and I had a couple little fucking dollar store pieces of shit hanging. Some
what
lights.
Is everybody like convene and in a parking lot or
yeah.
something?
Yeah,
you get in a big parking lot of the school, and then they you know they have a DJ.
You're parking a big circle,
and all the kids walk or run around with their friends
from
and
car
pay
to
no
car.
Attention and go from car to car, grabbing handfuls of candy. I put out a bowl of candy, and I had a couple of different lighted things and some skulls hanging from the car and all this other shit.
Oh wow!
And they had people. Who, I mean, they turned their car into a graveyard.
Yeah, some people.
I could show you pictures. Some people went fucking all out.
I like that.
They bring their car and it
one guy turned it into a castle.
So if you get like
a lot of people don't realize that Ed actually invented trunk or treat.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
You open it up and there was a hooker there. That
right.
was the treat.
Well, allegedly.
It started out so innocent.
Hey, I'd rather have a hooker.
Actually.
If I'm walking around, I'd rather have someone throw a hooker in my basket.
They renamed it because it used to be, what is it, a trunk or trick.
It was trick or trunk.
Trick alive. Or
tricks
dead?
In the trunk.
No, actually, his was trick and trunk.
Yeah.
Yeah, but if you have 20 cars go to this thing,
no,
say.
There's like 150.
Yeah, there's a lot.
Cars.
Of
oh, 100. I was gonna like, say, if you have 20
it's
cars,
in a school yard.
After they go around, then what?
No, they keep going around until
they
done.
They go home.
They keep
candy.
Going around.
Are you serious?
I had a bowl of 500 pieces of candy. It was gone in a half an hour. And the whole thing lasted 3 hours.
Because they just run around their friends.
I think it's much better.
Like, yeah, I thought, okay, and cool. I got these little things. And these people, the people next to me set up a pickup truck with a thing you throw a football at. It had demon heads on it.
Oh,
and next
wow.
to them was a basketball court with full-size skeletons that glowed in the dark and they had green eyes. They actually won the contest the best.
Well, that's cool.
Well, the reason why
I wanted machine on the back of the truck, smoke pouring out. It was actually really awesome.
As far as trick-or-treating goes, I think it depends on the individual. Everybody has I stopped at 15, but everybody...
After a while, you lose interest in it.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, I didn't trick-or-treat this year because I didn't have my kids with me, but if I did... We were going to be Star Wars this year, and of course, I was going to be Princess Leia.
A lot of the older kids in my neighborhood, when they got to a certain age, they would go around and steal candy from other kids, which was
of course.
Well, didn't you guys go bombing?
The high school kids would go around and get them.
We had a mischief night. Duh. We did all that nonsense. Yeah.
Rub soap on people's cars, toilet paper, shaving cream.
See, we didn't have that in Long Island. That's a Jersey thing. That wasn't a Long Island.
You know what?
They don't have mischief night in Long Island or devil's night.
We didn't have that.
But didn't you do it on Halloween night? After hours, you didn't go bombing?
No, we didn't have that in Long Island, I'm telling you.
You know, that explains a lot about Long Island.
In Jersey, at least, it was the night before.
Yeah, it was night before. Mischief night was the night before.
Yeah, it was a Jersey thing.
No, the reason why, even though I know Halloween is past, but there was a big story in the paper, and I want everybody's input on this. There was two stories. There's a guy in Weartown. He decorated his front lawn in Weartown. Oh,
yeah. They have lawns in Weartown?
And he had a car, and he had the car up against the tree with a dead body that he... position,
pinned up against the
car. And it looked real, and he kept getting the police kept getting phone calls. Oh my God, there's an accident. So they finally said, listen, you know, you gotta. But he said, this is my property, I'll do what I want. Secondly, another guy hung up, he claims was a scarecrow hanging from his porch, like a hanging person.
Yeah.
Right. Now there was no discernation of color, you couldn't tell what color this person was. Mm-hmm. So a guy who lived in that area, this was in Salem County, I don't know the specific town, he called the prosecutor's office.
Said they hung a witch.
No, I don't know.
Well, Salem.
It probably looked like a regular person. It didn't look like a ghoul or nothing.
It was just a regular person. They had the burlap sack over the head. You couldn't tell if it was a male, female, white, black, whatever. He's like, that's a racist thing. He sent two prosecutors, two detectives over from the prosecutors. They wanted him to take it down. He's like, listen, I celebrate Halloween. This is what I do. It's once a year. I said, it's not meant to be offensive to anybody. It's
so make it a scarecrow or make it a character or something.
It was a scarecrow.
Well, make it clear.
But you can't see the face.
The guy didn't see it that way, and he started a whole big to-do.
But that's so ridiculous, because around this time of year, you'll see someone with a fake hand hanging off of a trunk of a car or a foot.
But everybody thinks that it's getting out of hand with the decorations. But that is what Halloween. It's not just about putting a little pumpkin.
I don't think it's getting out of hand with the decorations. I think it's getting out of hand with the people being offended by everything.
Yeah,
right.
Well, that's what's getting out of hand.
I'll be honest. If someone came to my house and said, "Hey, you have to take this down. It's offensive. I'm putting an Al Jolson mask on the thing."
Yeah. Well, you know.
I'm putting two more of whatever it is up.
It's not the fact that they're faulting the people for celebrating. They're saying that it's getting too much gore, and that's not what Halloween is.
Well, it is.
No, I know, but I'm just
saying.
Have you
seen the movie Halloween?
That's their argument.
But
though.
I'm just saying, but with anything, they're wrong. Even Christmas, people are too jolly.
Yeah, you can't say Merry Christmas.
Too much lights on the house.
You have to say Happy Holidays and all that.
You can't even say ho 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 anymore.
Well, not near your car.
No. He hears that in the trunk.
Yeah. They don't get anything back.
What pissed me off last year was now they're not allowed to put Christmas trees in the town squares in certain towns.
I'm tired of it all.
Come on, seriously.
We have a Christmas tree in our town square.
I'm tired of it all.
Are they doing Lyndhurst?
You know what? It's insane.
I'll tell you what. Lyndhurst not only has a Christmas tree in town square, for Halloween, they section off, they have an emergency street. We have several.
Emergency?
Yeah. They have an emergency. I've been talking for an hour and a half.
He's parched.
Have you been stumbling all hour and a half?
Yes. No, only the last 20 minutes.
Emergency street.
So they have an emergency street called Page Avenue.
That was good that time.
The cops section off Page Avenue. The town donates.
So they turn the page.
Everybody donates candy to Page Avenue, and the kids just trick-or-treat up and down house to house on Page Avenue.
I like that.
Everybody decorates, and it's huge. Page Avenue is like 2 miles long.
Wow.
Right.
So the kids got plenty of room to run around with decorations and trick-or-treating all that.
Thank God it's only one day.
Off. Yeah.
Thank God it's only one day.
Thank God it's only one day for people to get offended.
People's mind, unfortunately, can make you know, put fear in other people.
Well,
you
look,
know.
At, look at Morristown school system. They canceled their Halloween everything and said, no, we're going to do an escape room instead because it's inclusive.
But right. even yeah. having...
So you're not allowed to celebrate Halloween
except for the handicapped
kids
that can't
aren't
escape.
Other kids aren't yeah. allowed, so that means right. everyone's not allowed.
But right. it's scary. Like the,
and that's a load
in
of
Nutley,
horseshit.
When someone, they said they trick-or-treating and they shot the guy. Like, has that, does that really happen? Did that really happen?
In that could really happen in July. What's the difference?
Yeah. I'm saying, but this is a place where you would think you're putting candy out for kids to make them happy, you know, and then, you know, trick or treat, open a door, and boom, you're dead.
But there was a story, I believe it was on Facebook, the mother did a live video. Her kid went to seven houses.
Yeah.
She went to open up a Twizzler, and it was like a big...
A long needle.
A long sewing needle inside of it. Like, who? Like seriously, you got to be disturbed.
They are, obviously.
Oh, you know? Yeah. Because when I was a kid, the big thing was
if
us.
You only went to seven houses, you could pretty much figure out.
They should definitely.
Oh, that's what they said. They said they were going to knock on.
They should definitely do away with the trick or treating thing. Do like you said, the trunk thing, or have a party at someone's house. No more going door to door stuff to random houses. They should do away with that. That's
there's
dangerous.
There's too many wacky people out there.
No doubt about it. No doubt about it.
It's a different time too. And you know what? Also, the kids these days, being millennials these days, I know even for the past 1 year, my kids, they were like, oh, you know, when I was a kid, we used to go around Jersey City for 2.5 hours and fill up a pillowcase. Then we would get in the car and drive to North Bergen to my grandmother's house and go for
again.
Another 2 hours and fill up another pillowcase. We had shit. We had loot like you wouldn't believe.
Right.
Nowadays, my kids are in it. We're walking around for 25 minutes. Yeah, I'm done.
Right.
Like, they don't really give a shit about the
candy. Yeah, do away with the trick-or-treating. Do away with the trick-or-treating.
Yeah.
You know? Keep an eye on the Skype, all right? Let me know when it comes up. We're connected.
This is a question of the day. How about a question?
Go ahead.
Oh, I have one.
Go ahead.
All righty. Inquiring minds. You're opening a traveling circus. Describe your featured acts and their talents. I knew it was
way
them.
To go.
So say it again. I didn't even hear the question. Though.
All right. Let's start this over.
All right. You're opening a traveling circus. Describe your featured acts.
I'd have us right
and
here.
And their talents.
Yeah, I'd have
this
us.
This would be it. This would be the main event.
What else
hurry,
do you need?
Hurry, hurry,
hurry. Yeah. Hurry.
Step right up.
The
step
greatest
right up.
Show on earth.
So.
I would have the comedy tornado. Often here.
I'd have a full moon.
Well, I bet you would.
I bet, yeah. Together we'll make an ass of each other.
Yeah.
A traveling circus. I don't know. What would the name of the traveling circus?
Traveling Wilburys.
Monty Python's Flying Circus.
Barnum and Bailey's available.
And now for something completely different.
Yeah, right.
No.
Hey, what was the name of your traveling circus be?
Mine?
Dead hookers and duct tape?
Yeah.
No, just hookers and duct tape.
Yeah.
You have to find out that they're dead. That's part of the surprise. Yeah, you don't want to ruin it. You want people to pay to get in to see this.
If he throws if he throws in dead, then the only audience will be cops.
You guys got a caller.
Hi, it's Ken Wahl calling.
Hey, hello. All right, everybody. It is 9 o'clock on the dot. First celebrity interview of the evening. This man is an iconic actor, TV star, you name it, and we are pleased and honored to have him on the show tonight. I know everybody's been excited about this all day. Please join us in welcoming, making his Animal House radio show debut, Mr. Ken Wahl.
Yes.
Yay.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks for calling
in. Thanks for having me.
Thank you.
Ken, you have no idea what it means to have you on this show. I've been a fan of yours.
He's not lying. He talks about it a lot.
He does.
For me.
All right, now I'm worried.
Well, it's all downhill from here.
He's a stalker. Watch out, Ken.
No.
I know. That's what I'm talking about. Yeah, I know. It's my pleasure, you know, guy. Anything for the troops. And especially now that it's just a few days until Veterans Day. So I'm more than happy to do it.
And I have so many questions. I just don't know where to start. But
well, when you figure it out, you want to call me back?
Yeah. No, how did it, for you, Ken, how did it start? How did Ken Wahl say, hey, I want to be an actor?
Well, okay, I'll tell you. How long is this show? I'll try to give you the Cliff Notes version of this.
Okay.
When I was a kid, I actually wanted to be a professional baseball player, probably from the age of 4, as early as I can remember. I mean, I even had baseball pajamas. They were the only ones that I would wear, okay?
Oh, wow.
And when I was about 14, 15, I was on a buddy's dirt bike, and I wiped out, and I smashed my knee against a rock. And that slowed me down enough that I couldn't play anymore. So I had to try to figure out what else I could do with my life. Now, keep in mind that I was just a working class, lower middle class kid from the south side of Chicago.
Right.
My dad is a non-union mechanic. You know, it's not like we worried about the next meal, but the one after that was a bit in question. So, you know, we didn't have any money. I had no money, no connections, no education. I had to drop out in 11th grade so I could work. So I thought, when I would see TV, I thought, you know what, that doesn't look like that's such a big deal to me. I think I could do that if I gave it a try. So I just worked 2-3 jobs at a time to save up enough money to go out to California to give it a shot. And I got lucky, to be quite honest. I saved up $740 and went out to California, and I thought to myself, I had a plan. I thought, I'll give myself a year and a half, and if nothing happens in a year and a half, I'll go back home, learn a trade, maybe try to be an electrician or a plumber, something where I could earn a decent living, right, and do that. Because I didn't want to be one of these guys that you hear about that waits tables at a restaurant for 35 years waiting for their big break.
Right.
To me, that would be just a waste of life. But I thought, if I don't try this, I'll always wonder my whole life. So I thought I'd give it a shot and see what happens. Now, everybody from my family, my friends, the guys I worked with, they all told me I was crazy. And instead of arguing with them, see, I was very pragmatic about it. I didn't have stars in my eyes. I didn't think, oh, I can't wait to see my name in lights and all that kind of thing. I just wanted to make enough money so that I didn't have to worry about money.
Right.
I mean, I didn't care about having mansions or Rolls Royces and things like that. I just wanted enough money that I could put in the bank, help out my parents, my siblings, my friends, and just not worry about money. Because right, my whole life growing up, it was always about money. You know, we had to go to this store instead of that store because a gallon of milk was 2 cents cheaper.
Right.
You know, things like that. And I just got so sick of that. I just thought, I just want to be able to make enough money not to worry about money.
Right.
So that was really my driving force. But at the same time, like I said, I didn't want to go out and just be a Hollywood hanger-on for decades waiting for my big break. So I said, I'll give it a year and a half. If it works, great. If not, I'll go back home and learn a trade.
Right.
And I got lucky. It took, instead of a year and a half, it only took me 4 months.
Wow.
So I really lucked out.
I read years ago that it was a rough beginning for you in the acting business, and your agent was just about to say, listen, we there's nothing we could do, and then Wise Guy hit.
No, that's totally wrong. That's
okay.
Totally fabricated.
Okay.
I didn't even have an agent. No, there was nothing like that. You can't just go out there and get an agent. If you haven't done anything, you won't be able to get an agent.
Right.
No, I was just a regular guy. I had the apartment building that I was staying at. A girl upstairs got a new camera, right? And she wanted to test it out. And I said, well, hey, take some pictures of me so I can send out to the different studios and casting offices. So she said, sure. And I didn't have any money to get duplicates, so she even lent me the money to get duplicates made up. So I had 50 duplicates made up of the pictures she took, and I just sent them around to the different studios and casting offices. And one day I got a call. So there was no agent involved or anything.
Oh,
it was just a matter of sending these things out and wait for a call. If you got a call, you go in, and that's exactly what I did.
Oh, wow.
There was a casting person by the name of Tony Howard who worked for Lynn Stallmaster, who was a huge casting person at the time.
Yes.
They still might be, for all I know.
Yeah.
And we just had a meeting. We talked for about 10 minutes, and she said, okay, great. I'm going to fly out to New York to meet the director. So they flew me out to New York. I met Phil Kaufman, the director of The Wanderers. We did a 2.5-minute video screen test. I went home. Thank you very much. 2 days later, I got a call. They said, you got the part. Not just the part, but the lead part in The Wanderers. So off I went. Yeah, I mean, it's really is the true American story. You know, this guy, this kid from nowhere, this nobody from nowhere, who just comes out of the blue and gets his shot. You know, only in America could that happen. And it really is a true Horatio Alger story.
It was meant to be, Ken.
Well, yeah, I was just... I'm so very grateful that that happened.
Ken, this is Shay Farrell. I just had a question. What year did you go out to California?
1978.
Oh, wow. How long were you there before you got that call?
Four months.
Okay, I was.
I got there in April of 78, and I got the call in August of 78.
That's wow. So cool. That's awesome. So cool. I love that.
You know what?
I know the exact date. I mean, August 28th, 1978
Oh, look at that.
Is when I got called in.
Wow. 2 days later, I was in New York. It was right before Labor Day. 2 days later, I went to New York, did the whole screen test thing. And on the way back to L.A., because they have to fly out and everything, so it was great. It was the first time I ever flown first class. It was fantastic. I instead split the ticket and went to Chicago to see my dad. And they called me in Chicago at my sister's house and said, you got the part. I said, wow, fantastic. And we want you back here next Thursday for wardrobe fittings and all that stuff, and you're going to play the lead part in The Wanderers. Oh, fantastic. Wow. Let's go. Oh, wow.
And then it just kept rolling from there?
Yeah.
Just kept rolling from there, yeah. We got, you know, The Wanderers didn't do very well in its initial theatrical release because it was up against a movie called The Warriors.
Right.
Which a lot of people confused, but The Warriors was set in the present day,
right,
and it had a lot of violence in it. I mean, gang violence.
Right.
Now, we had gangs in The Wanderers, street gangs, but it wasn't nearly as violent as The Warriors was.
Right.
But Warner Brothers, the distributor of The Wanderers, got scared and thought that there was going to be riots because the kids were going to riot after seeing this violence on screen.
Right.
Because with the Warriors, a couple people did get killed in riots in theaters in New York and in Chicago, too, I believe. So Warner Brothers really got frightened and said, we got to pull back the release of this movie, which they did.
Yeah.
So it did very poorly in its initial release. But as time went on and then video, VHS came out, and then DVDs came out and Blu-rays, it kept gaining, and it's much more popular now
than
it ever was when it was originally released.
Yeah, it's a classic now.
Personally, I can't speak for the other guys, but myself, I knew that we were doing something special. It just felt special when we were doing it.
Right.
To me, it was much more than just a movie about teenagers and gangs, because it really was an end of an era type movie, because if you remember the movie at all, it took place right at the time of the Kennedy assassination, Kennedy, JFK, President Kennedy.
Right.
So it took place in the fall, November of 1963.
Right.
And it was all about how things were changing from the way things were in the 50s to the way they were in the 60s.
Ken, I think Tony has joined us online. Tony, you there?
Yes, sir, I am.
All right.
There he is. Nice. Hey, how you doing? Can he hear me?
Yeah, can you hear
me?
I can't hear Tony that well. Tony's got to be brought up more.
So the dynamic
This is the one time that you want to turn the volume up on Ganios, that's for sure. Let me tell you that.
Let me tell you something.
Thanks a lot, man. Thanks a lot.
How you doing, buddy?
I'm doing pretty good, man. So I'm hearing you tell the whole thing about the Wanderers, how that happened, and
The thing with Tony, you know, Tony had no interest in the movie business at all. He was only 18,
right?
And the way that they got him was such a great story, because a casting director, one of the casting people, was walking to work one day. She happened to pop her head into a gym where Tony was working out, and because he was taller than everybody else, she spotted him and thought he'd be perfect for another part in the movie. So she went to her office, called the gym, and said, hey, who's that guy, the dark hair, tall guy, working in the gym? And of course, Tony thought that they were playing a joke on him and didn't believe it. And Tony's uncle talked him into going in and trying out for this movie, and that's how Tony got into the movie business.
When either shooting The Wanderers or Wiseguy, did Tony ever bring cottage cheese to the set?
Hey, Carlo, get Katsu with the cottage cheese.
He can't let that go, Tony.
What's with cottage cheese? I don't get
Jesus.
It.
Now, he told us a story when he was filming Porky's. He was on the set and he was eating cottage cheese, and a guy was making fun of him. So Tony went over to the car and got underneath the front bumper and started bench pressing, and then went back to eating his cottage cheese and said, okay, we good now?
Okay, well, as far as Porky's is concerned, I want to state right here and right now, I had absolutely nothing whatever to do with Porky's. Okay? So I take myself out of that conversation, you know. Tony was with me at the beginning with the Wanderers, and he was with me in Wiseguy.
Yeah.
Whatever happened to
he's seen you do like all kinds of stupid things over the years. So if he wasn't there for that one incident,
I know. I love Tony. I we talk all the time on the phone.
I know.
Yeah.
I just a little bit.
I got to clear up something else, Ken. When you were when you were directing some of the episodes of Wiseguy, is it true that Tony always had a problem with hitting his mark?
No, Tony hit his mark. Hey, listen, I'll go beyond that. Tony is one of the few guys, and I include myself in this, so I apologize in advance for patting myself on the back a little bit. Tony and I are some of the very few actors that can hit their mark without looking at it.
Right,
right.
If you watch in a lot of movies, when a person is walking towards the camera and they have to stop whatever distance from the camera, almost invariably you will see them looking down to see their mark before they walk on it.
Right.
Before they hit it, I should say. Right. And Tony and I are the only two actors that I've ever known and all the hundreds of actors that I've worked with that did not have to look at their mark before they hit it.
Yeah. Well, Tony only had to take...
Tony was great at that. One thing Tony was bad at that I got when I was directing him was that he had a tendency to always put his hands in his pocket, and that used to drive me nuts. I really had an affinity right away for him because I knew that he was looked upon by most people as, well, he's just another big guy goon. And nothing could be further from the truth.
Exactly, absolutely.
And part of that is even Tony's to blame, because I know that he likes to do, and it's not really to be taken seriously, but he likes to come off as like a big guy, I'm going to kick your ass, I'm going to kill you.
Right.
But the intelligence that this guy has, the sensitivity, the artistry that he has been dismally underserved. And no, he's not paying me for this. Tony Ganios was looked upon as just because of his physical size, that he was some kind of a goon.
No,
and it always aggravated me.
We know better. We know better. We've interviewed him. We know how intelligent he is.
I talk to him on the phone all the time. He tells me great
stories.
Well,
you guys might know it, but I'm saying to anybody who may be listening that hadn't heard it before,
it's true.
Right.
I'm telling you, as someone that has been his best friend for the last 38 years, what a wonderful guy this guy is on so many levels.
And if anybody doesn't believe you, Ken, Tony will come and kick their ass.
Yeah,
thanks a lot.
He won't come and kick your ass. No, he won't.
Hey, Carlo, you should drive down to the studio tonight, because if you see your car going up and down, it's me doing bench presses with it in the parking lot. Wait for you to come out.
No, Tony, you know I love you, brother. I just was getting kicked out of
this. I know. You're just breaking my cool
rules.
That's all. But Tony's physical strength is really only about 10% of what the man is.
That's right. Definitely. I agree.
And I'm just so happy that I have the opportunity to say this over the air.
Yep.
Because I would tell that to anybody who listened, because I would always feel so bad. Oh, yeah, Tony Gunn, the big guy, he lifts cars and shit. We all know he's big and strong, but he's so much more than that.
Sure he is.
I pick things up and put them down.
God. You know, I'm going to kick your ass.
Now, the reason why it came up, Ken, is because Tony was telling me a story during the romp that he had to get in a car and drive around the corner, and you were telling him, what did you drive so fast for? And he's like, what are you talking about? And I just got a kick out of it because it was a very light.
So we bust each other's humps all the time, you know, and that was the very first shot that I directed. So what I was doing was really playing a joke for the crew. Because the crew didn't know what I would be. Of course, they knew what I was like as an actor and even a producer and a writer on the show, but they didn't know how I would behave as a director.
Right.
So I put the fear of God into him, because when Tony did it, I started ranting and yelling and screaming. I could see the look on the faces of the crew like, oh, my God, we got a monster.
Hit her with a shit of wine they're watching.
When you give him the director's chair, he turns into a monster. So that was all just a joke. That was just a gag for the crew.
Oh, okay.
That's funny.
That was the very first shot that I directed. Tony was driving around the corner up to a curb, into camera. So he had to stop like 20 feet in front of the camera, and that was the very first shot he did. So I said, what the hell's the matter with you? Why did you go around so fast? What are you nuts? And the crew was just like, slack-jawed, because they didn't know what had happened to me. Like, I turned into C.B. DeMille all of a sudden. You know, everybody.
Then I looked and I saw that I hit my marks. I didn't understand what you were breaking my balls about.
And the crew was all looking at each other like, we got a madman on our hands here.
Kenny, it was just a gag.
I got to ask you something. I'll tell you, I want to talk about Wiseguy because that was my favorite TV show growing up. It's still my – I watch
Thank you. Thank you very much.
It's one of the first shows, and correct me if I'm wrong, that started
– Oh, I will. Believe me. I will.
Yes, you will.
It's one of the first shows that did the arc thing where they carried you along on a story for like 5 or 6 episodes. And
absolutely right.
And yep. I like that because, you know, it made people want to, because if you do it just a one-off show, maybe I'm not going to watch it this week, but you want to find out what happened. But what pissed me off is because it was on at 10 o'clock and they always preempted the damn thing for either an award show.
Yeah, we had big fights with CBS over that, but there's really nothing you can do. You know, once the network gives the production company their license fee, their money, which is really a license fee, is just a fancy way of saying they're renting the show to right. show that night. So the production company has no control over what the network does. So all we could do is just do the best we could. And one of the problems with Wiseguy at that time, because remember, Wiseguy ran from 1987 through 1990.
Right.
And inclusive. So those 4 years, there wasn't that much time shifting then as there is now. You know, now they'll repeat a show over and over again. So when I was growing up, I always hated it when they had television shows. Like the example that I always use is Mannix.
Right.
Okay? If you remember Mannix, and I know you younger people won't remember Mannix.
My kind of
Mannix was a detective show. And it was a perfectly adequate, fine show. Well, I watched it when I was a kid.
Right.
But what drove me nuts was, like, Mannix would get shot in the arm, right, in an episode. Mm-hmm. And the very next week, he was perfectly fine. And there was no mention of it. There was no... Every episode was self-contained.
Right, right.
And that always bothered me. Mm-hmm. So when Wiseguy came along, to Stephen J. Cannell's credit, he devised this where he wanted a 4 to 8 episode storyline
right.
with every particular nemesis to Vinny, my right. character.
I like that.
And I love that because all the shows were connected for that particular. So we were actually making a movie, in essence, that was just split up into segments.
Right.
And I love that. Yeah. And like you say, you love, but it didn't serve us well at the beginning because, as I said back then, people didn't record shows as often. And also, the networks didn't repeat them as often.
Right.
So it's like you got to see the original first-run episode during the normal television season, and then you had another opportunity to see it during the rerun season in the summer. And if you missed it, that's it. You're lost.
Right, right.
And so the other problem is that when you have a 7-episode storyline, if you miss one episode, you're completely lost. Because any of these other shows, I understand why they're self-contained, because you can come in on episode 1 and you can miss 2 and 3 and see episode 4 and you're fine.
Right.
But with our show, if you saw episode 1 and you missed episode 2, you came back for number 3, you don't know what the hell's going on.
Right. Right.
But you got to see them in order. So as a result of that, our ratings weren't very good when we started on one. Then again, like The Wanderers, Wiseguy is more popular now than it ever was when it was originally released.
Unbelievable when I tell people about, I love that show. Believe it, I'm a stand-up comic, right? And when I first started out in the business,
Man, I'm glad you told me that because I would have never known otherwise.
There you go.
He got me there.
Hey,
okay.
Hey, man, you wanted me on your show.
That's like a badge of honor. That's like getting insulted by Don Rickles. I'm on.
Yeah, there you go.
Where do you walk outside the parking lot, Carlo?
The executive producer of our show, and I kid you not, his name is Vinny Terranova.
Wow.
He's obsessed.
Well, I know one, there's another Vinny Terranova in Denver who works at the Harley shop in Denver, and he sent me his business card. Yeah, it was back like 1990-91, somewhere in there. So yeah, that, you know where that show was originally on television, the name Vinny Terranova, was on Charlie's Angels.
Oh, wow.
And, yeah, and that's where Steve Cano got the name. Because I asked him, where did you get this name? Because, you know, Terranova is Italian for new earth, new ground. And I asked Stephen Cano where he got that name. And he said, oh, when I was writing Rockford and all that, and he'd see all the other shows, there was a bad guy on Charlie's Angels, and his name was Vinny Terranova. And I just liked the way it sounded.
Yeah.
So he co-opted that name, code word for stealing.
He just stole the name and used it in Wise Guy. So that's where that came from.
Yeah, you know what it is. The show was brilliant. It's like it was a precursor for The Sopranos. David Chase actually.
Absolutely. You know? No question. And see, we also had the disadvantage of being on regular network television. So we were under the purview of the FCC, and, you know, we couldn't swear whether the Sopranos, every other word is fuck this, fuck that. Yeah, fuck you. Why? Yeah, no, fuck you. You know, it was on and on. And let me tell you a story about that.
That was just the love scenes.
Yeah, right. And those are the love scenes. So Vinny has a scene with his girlfriend, played by Patty Darbinville.
Right.
Okay? They split up. They get back together. So one time, Vinny goes back and sees her after a long absence. And he tries to seduce her. And he finally succeeds. And then she feels bad about it the next day, okay? The walk of shame the next morning. So the next morning, Vinny gets up and he's all happy and he says to Amber, his girlfriend, "Boy, we really need it last night, didn't we? That wasn't that wonderful?" And she says, "No, you idiot. You know, you had nothing better to do. So let's go and bang Amber," okay? That was it. She's saying that derisively to Vinny.
Right.
Well, CBS objected, their standards and practices, objected to the word bang as a euphemism for sexual intimacy.
Right.
So Patty had to loop the word, which means she had to exchange the dialogue in post-production from bang to bing. Yeah, that was the kind of restrictions we had on Wise Guy that The Sopranos and any other ensuing show did not have.
Right.
They had the bada bing, so it's almost
Yeah, right. Well, they had.
Yeah, that's what they used it from. But I said it makes no sense. Bada bing and bing in this context means exactly opposite of what you're trying to do. But anyway, it was another big fight with the network. We were always fighting with the network constantly.
Right.
And The Sopranos didn't have to worry about that because they were on cable.
Right.
You know what? Right. I think the appeal to Wise Guy is it was the first time you really saw the life of an undercover person and the struggles and the of how towards the end when you got really close to Ray Sharkey's character, Sonny Steelgrave, and you actually... You had feelings for him, but wait a minute. You're supposed to be an FBI agent. This is your job.
And
I'll tell you, it's just amazing that Ray Sharkey played. I mean, he was my favorite character on the show. Kevin Spacey, Mel Proffitt, brilliant role. I can't see between you and me, and I know because I'm a fan. I can't see no one else ever playing the role of Vinny Terranova beside you. You were born to play that role, and my favorite...
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much. That's a high compliment.
No, my favorite arc was the Dead Dog Records arc. That was my favorite.
Oh, yeah. And unfortunately, that isn't out on DVD because of all the music license problems.
Yeah. That was.
And I really felt bad about that because that, for me, was the most fun to do, the music business.
Right.
The most fulfilling one was the Ray Sharkey, because it was first of all, it was the first storyline. Mm-hmm. And second of all, it was because it was real neighborhood guys.
Right.
And the character like Sonny Steelgrave and a character like Vinny Terranova easily could have switched sides, by their chosen path in life.
Right.
Vinny could have easily been one of these street guys.
Right.
And Sonny could have, if he decided to, could have gone the right way and joined the FBI himself. And there was so much in common between Sonny and Vinny. And that's really what cemented my doing the show, because I was not at all looking to do a series. But it was just so good, I couldn't turn it down.
Yeah.
You know, the work schedule on a series is murder. Whereas on a feature film and even TV movies is much more relaxed.
Right.
But on a TV series, it's just nonstop.
And plus you had Joan Severance to look at. That was nice too.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. But now I was a producer of the show too, and I actually voted against Joan Severance. We did these things by committee, as far as storylines or what people call story arcs. I just never liked that.
Right.
I just call them storylines.
Right.
We would vote on the storylines, and we would vote on it. Well, I had cast approval in my contract
but I deferred to one of the other producers on the show,
right?
And because I had never heard of Joan Severance before,
right.
And yeah, she's pretty, big deal. There's a billion pretty girls. That's her acting ability. I didn't think was up to snuff for Wiseguy. Mm-hmm. And if you watch those episodes, you will see so much of how when Joan Severance speaks, the camera is off of her. The camera is on either Kevin Spacey or myself, right, reacting to what she is saying.
Okay.
Because her acting is just not that good. So we had to cut around her,
right,
all the time.
Oh, wow.
So,
are all those shows on DVD now? Are they all on DVD?
Most shows? Yes, yeah. Those are. Yeah, oh, they've been for a while.
Yeah, Carlo has the whole collection.
Yeah,
if you want to come
whole,
over.
I have the whole collection. And I was
yeah,
able.
Yeah, you have them all except the music business.
Oh, no, I got them.
He's got the coffee mug, too, and the tote.
I found a guy online that had him. I got the dead dog because Glenn Frey, Tim Curry, Isaac Twine. I just love
oh,
that.
Oh, man, I tell you, let me give some credit for all these guys. Glenn Frey, absolutely wonderful guy, sweet guy. You would never know he was as big a star as he is. If I'm not mistaken, the Eagles' greatest hits from 1971 to 75 is still, I believe, I'm not 100% sure, is still the biggest selling album of all time.
No, it's not number one anymore.
It's not the biggest, bigger than Thriller, Michael Jackson's Thriller, bigger than anything else you can think of as an album, not singles, but as an album.
Yeah, I just did a top 10 list on that. It was number three. It went down to number three.
Okay,
but it's in the top five.
That's not too bad.
Very high up there.
Yeah, it's really.
Tony, let me ask you a question. And I like the whole within the episode, the romp. It's almost like a Wanderers reunion. But you know, unless you were a Wanderers fan, you realize that with Jimmy Vitale and Mooch. Tony, what was it like playing that character, Mike Cacciatore?
Say that again. I'm sorry. It kind of cut out.
I said, what was it like playing the character Mike Cacciatore?
Well, I really liked it because that was the first time that I ever got to play against type.
Yes.
Because the way Kenny had me written in the show, I was a lawyer and I wasn't some guy that was sent to beat somebody up or some other kind of stupid thing like that. It was interesting, you know, doing that because I never got to do anything like that before. Where it was, but then when we did the episodes where it was. Like, you had the arcs, and then you had those freestanding episodes. And that's when I was there. I was there for the freestanders.
Right.
So the writers got a break between the arcs, right?
Right.
That's what
right.
happened.
Right.
Yeah. No, go ahead, Carla.
I was listening. You know, I just, all of them, I mean, and you got to, I mean, for Wiseguy, you did Ford Apache. You got to play with Paul Newman.
Yeah.
You got
yeah.
Kevin Spacey. You got Ray Sharkey. You got Stanley Tucci, who played Ricky Pinzolo. Jerry Lewis.
Stanley Tucci, right?
You know?
What was Nick Fleetwood and Glenn Frey, as you mentioned. We had Norman Lloyd, who was, if you don't know that name, here's a guy who's 103 years old. He's still alive, who used to work with Alfred Hitchcock.
Wow.
Oh,
wow.
Yeah, he was a producer on the show. Yeah.
Wow. Right. He was in our show.
Hmm.
And, that's how far back. Because people really, by the mid part of our second season, we really had a tremendous reputation within the industry where people were fighting to get on our show. They really wanted to be on it, you know, because they knew they could be on it. They didn't have to commit long term. They could just commit for 3, 4, 5 episodes, do really good work,
right,
and then move on. So we were really lucky in that sense that we had people just clamoring to do our show.
Yeah, you
so
know.
That's why we had so many good people on there. Jerry Lewis? You forgot Jerry Lewis?
Yeah, I was just going to say the Garment District storyline. Yeah. And
Ron Silver.
Ron Silver. You know what's funny, though? I got a kick out of the name. She had, like, No Money Mahoney, Harry the Hunch, Patty Patrice.
Pat the Cat. Oh, yeah, that's the fun of doing that stuff. Yeah, all those wacky names and shit. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The only one I didn't like, and I'll be honest with you, Ken, is I just wanted to punch Sid Royce right in his face, though. I swear to God.
Well, you were supposed to.
Exactly.
That,
doing
that
his
was
job.
The character he was playing. You
exactly.
wanted to punch him in the face.
Right.
Yeah, absolutely. He played that. He's another one. He's a great actor and a great guy. And he played that perfectly. He's such a slimy little guy. And, you just wanted to wrap him in the mouth with
right.
a baseball bat.
Right. He was doing a great
he
job.
He played that perfectly, but he's not like that at all.
Right.
Sweetest, quiet, soft-spoken guy you'd ever want to meet.
Yeah, right.
Joe D'Alessandro,
yes.
who goes back to the Andy Warhol days.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, it's incredible.
the people we had.
Who's the guy you had on there? There was a guy on there that was a state senator, a former state senator you had on one of the arcs.
Oh, Fred, Fred, Fred.
Right.
Fred Thompson, that's right, yeah, Fred Thompson, yeah.
And he had, you had Robert, Fred Thompson. Fred you had Thompson. Robert Dobby was Albert Sirico. You had Chaz Palminteri was like a,
that's right,
you know.
That's right.
I'll be honest with you, Ken, after you left, I love Stephen Bauer. I've met him several times. He's a great guy. I just couldn't watch it anymore.
Stephen Bauer, we've known him forever. But, yeah, he was ill-advised to try to step in and do, and they tried to make it a Latin theme and the whole bit, and it just didn't work. No, it was awful.
No, the show was done when you left. When you were done, when you left, the show was done.
Yeah, you know what? After I left, they called it Was Guy. So I got a kick out of that. Yeah, it just didn't work. No. It just didn't work. Even what they had Jonathan Banks, you know, jumping out of airplanes and doing stunts. You know, they turned Jonathan Banks into this snide little character into like an action guy. You know, action Frank McPike. Right. You know? And it just didn't work.
You know, we had Jim Burns on the show. He's a phenomenal guest.
Oh, another great guy. Yeah, fantastic. You know, lovely guy. Well, now, hold on here. Now, I didn't leave the business.
Carlo.
I had a terrible accident and got a terrible spinal injury, so I was forcibly retired.
Okay.
Right. So I heard a lot of rumors about that, too, about where I went and all that stuff. Nah, I just had an accident, and I had to retire. I couldn't work anymore. I tried.
Right.
I did two. Well, I got hurt in 1992, and then I was in the hospital for months, came back. The doctor did the surgeon that I had screwed up my operation. Did a terrible job, unfortunately. He just had a bad day, so it really messed me up physically. I tried to come back. I did a little TV movie as a test to see what I could do in 1994, and I'm right back in the hospital after that for a couple of months. And then again, I tried in 1996. I did the Wise Guy movie that I produced as well because I was just unhappy with the way that Wise Guy ended.
Right.
And then there again, I had to go back in the hospital after that, and I thought, that's it. I got to stop because I just couldn't handle it anymore physically because of my spinal injury.
Yeah. Now, with all the medical...
I didn't just, nonchalantly leave the business.
No, I didn't mean it like that. I apologize.
I was forcibly retired.
Yeah.
I will say, I was pretty much done with acting. I really wanted to get into directing. I loved directing, and I had a real knack for it, and I was really looking forward to doing that. Right. But I just couldn't. So.
Now, Ken, with all the medical advancements, they can't fix anything now? They can't go back and do it?
No, because unfortunately, the damage that the surgeon did on me was actually worse than the original injury.
Right.
Oh, boy.
And as a result of that, I'd have to sign a waiver. Believe me, I've did so many consultations, I can't even remember how many.
Right.
And they all say, look, we can try to re-break your neck and reset it and fix it. And it's, you know, it's not like a tibia to do that.
No.
You're dealing with the very high cervical vertebrae, C1, C2, which is right under the brain, under the skull.
Yeah.
And if you screw that up, I could end up quadriplegic or dead.
Yeah.
And I would have to sign a waiver to that effect
because
the surgery is so dangerous.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
So I thought, you know what? I don't even want to take that chance.
No, not
they say the 50-50 chance with this new surgery. So I said, you know what? Forget it. I'll just live with what I got. At least I can still walk.
Right.
You know, I'm in pain a lot, but I'll just tough it out. I'll just deal with it.
Right.
But I certainly can't go to work again, because I could really mess myself up and make myself
worse. Well, we don't want that to happen, but regrettably so. There's a lot of people that miss you, and, you know.
Well, I appreciate that. Thank you.
Even though you can't act right now, how do you think if they tried to reboot the show, would it work?
Wise Guy?
Yeah.
Well, you know, there was a plan 2 years ago to do that on NBC, and then it just died out because they couldn't find a good Vinny Terranova.
I don't think they're
going to. In my opinion, obviously I'm biased, but yeah, I think they could, especially because you've got to keep it in historical perspective.
Right.
The audience now is, when you take like the audience that networks and studios covet the most, are 18 to 49.
Right.
Okay?
Right.
The people that are 18 to 49 now are vastly different than the people that were 18 to 49 then.
Oh, no doubt. Yeah.
So I think, yeah, sure, they could reboot. I don't think it would be nearly as good. They have big shoes to fill. Let's put it that way.
Right.
And it might be possible
to get the writing staff that you had staff on the show.
But there's something, not just the writing staff, but the chemistry. You know, that's one thing that I could even look at objectively. When I was working on the show, it's one thing of being on the set and filming and everything, but something, for lack of a better word, something magical happens when it gets transferred to film. Because then when you see it on film, it truly does, unfortunately, to use another cliche, it really does take on a life of its own.
Right.
And I remember when I saw the pilot of Wiseguy, while I was working on it, I thought, this is good. We're doing great. And, of course, I loved the script. Right. Otherwise, I wouldn't have done it. But I thought, this is really good. This is good. I like the work we're doing here. But then when I saw it on film, it took on an even greater dimension because of the, wow, the chemistry between Sonny and Vinny and the chemistry between McPike and Vinny and even McPike and Sonny and Lifeguard. It all just gelled together. Right. And that's really lightning in a bottle where just all the moons line up and you get really lucky with that. It's too bad that it didn't do better in its original release. But such as it is, like I said, it's more popular now than it ever was originally. Right. So I'm grateful for that. Yeah. But I really knew once seeing it on film that we really had something special.
Right.
Hey, how you doing, Ken? I just wanted to ask one weird question about the Wanderers. When you guys had that final scene in the Teddy's, how good was that fucking food?
Not Teddy's.
It was Pugli's, a Little Italy, yeah.
Yeah, Little Italy.
Okay. How good was the food there?
Well, wait. Hold on. You know, let me feel this one. The food was good on the first take with the breaded you know, Goo Goo seal, but after, like, take three, when it got cold, it tasted like we were eating water pump gaskets.
We have even gone there just as regular customers to that place in Little Italy. And I say I would rather eat at Joe and Joe's in the Bronx, but it wasn't bad. It was okay.
Which is now defunct.
I got to hear. Now,
Joe and Joe's or Pugli's?
No, I don't know about Pugli's, but Joe and Joe's is defunct.
Right. Oh, I was asking you about that the other day. You said you didn't know. Is it gone, really?
No, I'm pretty sure it's gone.
Oh, man, I love that place.
Probably is, yeah.
Now, absolutely love that place.
With the Wanderers, Ken.
It
was a great story. It was like a coming of age, but with the Ducky Boys thing, it took like a dark turn, but it kept you enthralled. It was like a weird dynamic, but
I got to say that has been one of the most vociferous criticisms of the film was that it went from being very realistic and neighborhood guys to surreal when it came to the Ducky Boys, and that it didn't mesh. And I got to say, I somewhat agree with that criticism, because it did seem like, you know, when the guys are in the car and it's so real and down to earth and we really are in the Bronx and we're really on the real streets and everything, and then all of a sudden everything gets fog shrouded and we're surrounded by these midget demons or dwarf demons. So I don't mean to be politically incorrect there.
Right.
Dwarf demons, okay? And it did go from the real to the surreal and back again. And I think, that it didn't really work for me either, to be quite honest with you. But that's really the only criticism that I have of it. Of course, I'm extremely biased.
Well, no,
but
you should be. You should be.
All right, wait. A lot of ladies, you have a lot of fans out there.
Go ahead.
How was it like being a heartthrob?
Who are you talking to?
Sorry, Tony. I love you, but I'm talking again.
No, I'm laughing. The way you asked that, I just thought it was funny. Go ahead.
What's it like being a heartthrob? Is that what you said?
Yeah.
And even my mother had a crush on you. Come on.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate that. But, you know, that whole heartthrob thing, it's ridiculous.
Was it overrated?
No, not that it's overrated. It's just silly.
Did you see yourself as a heartthrob?
I mean, because when here's the thing.
I have someone writing to me right now. She's saying your voice is, she's going to be up all night because your voice sounds the same as it did back then.
Oh, this is a family show.
Armed forces. There's women in the military
it is a fucking family show.
I'm fine with that. Look, I've loved women my whole life. I even thought when I was a little kid that I was weird. Because
because remember when boys are little, most of them think girls got cooties.
Yeah,
right.
I never went through that stage.
Yeah, my son Dante
either. I always loved little girls. Even when when I was little, I loved little girls, and I loved big girls.
That's my son.
When I got older, I only liked women. Okay, so let's get that straight.
Gotcha.
But I'm saying even when I was little, I never thought of girls having cooties. I thought they were just adorable and cute. So I thought there was something wrong with me. Like, I was weird because I liked girls.
But
obviously, I realized I was fine later on. But being a heartthrob is great. I mean, look, like I said, I've said this before. When I got that Us magazine thing, the sexiest guy on TV, right? I honestly, truly
hated
it.
Sorry, Tony. No, I'm okay.
And I'll tell you why I hated it. I hated it because, first of all, every straight guy in the world now is going to hate your guts.
Wow.
Okay?
Right.
And that's most of your fan base right there.
Right.
Second of all, in that context, people are very fickle. So it's like, yeah, you're the sexiest guy this week, but next Thursday it'll be somebody else, right?
Right.
So it's not all that flattering. It's not that big of a deal. Plus, you got all your friends and your brothers and your buddies breaking your balls all the time. Oh, sexiest man. You know, all that shit you got to deal with. So that's no good. Plus, when women are around you and they know that you know that you have been named the sexiest man on television, they don't act like they're falling all over you. They get defensive. They act the exact opposite.
Right.
Because they want to show, oh, I don't think you're so hot.
Right.
Right? They do that thing. So it actually has the exact opposite effect.
Right.
Even though I acted exactly the same because I thought it was silly. Now, don't get me wrong. That doesn't mean that I'm not glad that some women find me attractive. Right. I love that. Of course, any guy would.
Right.
Any straight guy would love women finding him attractive.
Right.
But if it becomes the primary, most important thing about you, that's death. Especially as an actor, when you're trying to do your best to be taken seriously as an actor.
Right.
Like, oh, now I don't take myself seriously as a person being an actor, but as far as acting being my livelihood, I took it extremely seriously.
Right.
Because I never wanted show business to be my life. I wanted show business to provide me with a life. And it did that because I had a whole life outside of show business. I was very good at keeping it separate.
Right.
You know, this is my job. I was very pragmatic, very practical. I got a job to do. Go to work, do your job. Then you go home and you're just a regular guy.
Exactly.
And I like that. I like just being the regular guy. So this whole heartthrob thing, it's not like women are falling at your feet or anything.
No.
So it's okay, but it's just silly. It's just silliness. And it's just something that the media creates in order to sell magazines.
Are you still the elbow titting champ of the Bronx?
No, that was Joey. That wasn't me.
Oh, I thought that was, okay.
No, he was the elbow titting champion of the Bronx. Yeah, that was Joey.
Oh,
that's funny. That was great.
Remember? And then he got picked up by the giant girl and thrown down on the sidewalk.
That's funny. I love that. That's what,
that
you know,
was
what,
Joey.
You know what, Kenny? That's The Wanderers is one of those movies like Animal House and all that no matter how many times it's on, you're always going to watch it and you know all the parts.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Hey, Tony.
Yeah, I could pretty much recite Animal House myself.
Yeah, that was, you know.
And it adds, of course, Animal House has the added poignancy of Belushi being dead.
Yeah.
Unfortunately. Where I think it's great that after all these years, we're still alive, all of us.
Well,
even Jimmy.
Yeah. You and Tony are.
The most amazing thing about Jim Youngs, you know, who played Buddy Borsellino, the most amazing thing about Jimmy is that he's
there's a guy that's a natural born heartthrob.
Yes, Jimmy, absolutely.
I don't know. This guy, if he walks into a room, women just go nuts, make like they just go, oh, you don't think it's Jimmy? Honest to God. He's seen it too.
Right. Jimmy works the ladies, whereas I never did. I have a lot of sisters. I grew up with a lot of females, so I never had this thing also where I thought of women as mysterious creatures. I never went through any of that. To me, they were just people who were equipped differently than me.
Sure the hell are.
I was very happy that they were equipped differently than me.
Right. And
I never thought of them as some, like, otherworldly. I mean, some guys look at women as though they're like a different species. And I just never had that. You know, I just treated women normally like anybody else. And they seem to respond to that.
Me and Tony talk a lot. We've become close friends, and I consider him like my older brother, and I have the utmost respect for him. Even though I may break his balls that he still uses a percolator, I still love the guy. When I was asking you about the gangs in this movie, were they? I believe you told me that they were actually taken after some real life.
Some of them were real. Like the Fort and Baldies were real. The Wanderers were not real. The Ducky Boys were real, but they were the way Richard Price wrote them in the novel. Okay, there's a guy, and let me I can't remember his name, but he wrote a series of books called Lost Boys of the Bronx, and he wrote a book about the Ducky Boys. And Richard Price, I think, got the idea that they were all small, not because they were stunted, but because they were little kids. A lot of them were like little kids, and they were real. What was interesting, what was strange is that there were no Puerto Rican gangs in the movie. That was a little strange.
Right.
There were a lot of Puerto Rican gangs, and the most fearsome gang in the city at the time was the Harlem Red Wings. I don't know if you guys remember the Harlem Red Wings. They had a shootout with the Fort and Baldies at Orchard Beach in 1954. They don't mention the Harlem Red Wings at all, but a lot of the gangs in the movie were made up, but a few, like the Ducky Boys and the Baldies, were real.
So they were a hockey team.
No, because I also, one of the gangs you mentioned, and I could have swore from Brooklyn when you guys were
looking. Golden Guineas.
The Golden Guineas, yeah.
That was real, too. They were real, yeah.
Yeah, so that was.
But they weren't in the Wanderers.
No. But they're mentioned in the. They're mentioned. You mentioned them, in fact. You mentioned them when we're doing you're doing a bowling alley scene. You're trying to get them.
Right.
Yeah.
Jimmy comes with his list.
Right, that's the thing.
Right. Came with the list.
That was something Phil created. That Phil Kaufman, the director, created that. The Baldies were guys with ducktails, and I've even heard a rumor that Dion DiMucci himself was a Baldy. I don't know if that's true. I mean, you keep hearing stories about all kinds of crazy things.
Dion DiMucci was the lead singer of Dion and the Belmonts.
Right, Dion DiMucci is
from The Wanderer. Okay, right. Just for clarification purposes.
Well, were the Belmonts bald?
Well, they might be now, but no, they weren't bald back then.
Probably now, yeah.
Listen, I got an idea for you two guys. Listen, Ken, I think we're going to do a reboot of Wise Guy, but Ken, you don't actually have to appear in the series.
Just direct.
You could be like...
Thank you.
No, no.
I don't have to.
No.
He gave you permission.
No, you could be like Charlie.
Thank you very much. Jeez, I was worried there.
No. Okay. You could be like Charlie from Charlie's Angels and just use your voice. You could be like where Frank McPike is now. Now you're running.
Yeah, okay. Well, let me stop you right there. Anytime I hear a fabulous original idea like that, like, hey, you could be like the guy on Charlie's Angels, I got to kind of stop you right there, okay? Thanks anyway. Next.
I have a question, Ken. I have a question. Yes. This is Paul Venier again. I just want to know, you're saying girls don't have cooties, right?
None of the girls I've ever been with have had cooties, correct?
Okay, good. I got to write that down. Okay.
I'm going to ask this question to Ken and then Tony.
Girls and women are the reason for living, as far as I'm concerned.
They make the world go around. He's true, because all guys want to impress girls. We do everything. Everything we do is to impress girls.
Yeah.
You got to be careful today in what you say, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Not girls, women.
Right.
Women rule the world.
No doubt about it.
Because men will do just about anything to get them and have them.
Carlo, write that down.
It's true.
And by the way, I want to impress this upon you. That is not a complaint.
No, it's true.
That is just an observation of the way it is. And
you're right.
Furthermore, I like it that way. That's the way it should be.
If it wasn't for women, we'd still be living in caves.
That's right. You know what? I wanted to mention something. Ken and his wife, Shane, they do a lot of charity work, which is commendable. And
thank you.
I think in 2010, you actually offered your Golden Globe Award as part of a reward.
Yeah, I did. Oh, now this story's going to bring me down, because some dirtbag, sick bastard of a person glued a little kitty cat to a road so that it would be just suffering and screaming and crying until some car came along and hit it and crushed it.
Oh,
and I was so moved, so disturbed by that story. that I offered my Golden Globe as a reward to the person that found the person that did that. And oh, wow. But they never did. They never wow. found it.
That's so sad.
Never found the person.
No, but I follow you on Twitter, Ken, and I you're a big supporter of our military. With God bless you for that, mm-hmm. and you
thank you,
and the police and all the first responders. And
absolutely,
I think, you know,
me, those guys, all of those guys are heroes.
They are.
And you know why I say they're heroes? Because my definition of a hero is anybody that signs their name on the dotted line to volunteer to protect my life at the expense of their own. To right. me, that is a hero.
Absolutely.
So that includes all the military, firemen, policemen,
yep.
EMS, all first responders of any kind, because they would sacrifice their own life to save mine.
Absolutely.
That is a hero in my book.
I agree 100%.
Yeah, and you know yes. what? Like, and this goes for Tony, too. There's a lot of people out there. Some are left, some are right. But you two guys, when I talk, I see your tweets on Twitter, Ken, and I talked to Tony. You guys get it. You guys, because
yeah.
I think because of the old school factor, and you just, that's why.
Well, I think that old school thing is overused. It's just the way that, number one, the way we were brought up.
Yeah, respect.
And number two, just the way we see the world. And it's a little thing called common sense.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, that is really, unfortunately, very uncommon. You know, they're out all in all far-flung places on the planet, so you can have the freedom to do whatever the hell you want to do. I don't know how a person cannot be grateful for that. And I hope everybody sees my tweet that I did for Veterans Day. I've already put it up because I like to do it a few days early.
Right.
And it means a lot to me because I always do that for Memorial Day, for Veterans Day, or, you know, all the military holidays. And I'm really very sincere when I say thank you so much to everybody in the military for allowing me to have the freedoms. You gave me the freedom to be able to do the Wanderers and Wiseguy and to follow my dreams and to be able to succeed at my dreams. Had it not been for all those guys that came before me and did what they did to protect the freedoms of this country, I wouldn't have been able to do what I have done.
Yeah.
And I am forever grateful.
And I got to tell you, I'm a comedian myself. This is Paul Venier again. And I do a lot of fun. I mean, I do tons of fundraisers, mostly for PBA, youth sports, firemen, you name the whole gamut, soldiers. And I had a woman once said, well, your career's not going well. You're doing this show for firemen. I said to her, and I'll say the same thing. I know how you feel. I said the same thing. I said, I consider this an honor. I'm doing something for these people that give their lives for people, and you think this is
a bad thing? That's right. You cannot control what other people think
or
other people say, so there's no sense in even worrying about it.
I didn't. I just walked away from
you,
it.
You know in your heart that you feel the right way, you're doing the right thing,
right.
And that's all that matters.
Yep.
And the people that are like-minded will realize that too.
Yeah,
so you just got to ignore those people because all it does, you're just wasting energy on them and they don't deserve your energy.
Yeah, I don't give to negativity.
You're absolutely
I don't give to it
right.
at all. Right.
I'm so honored to have the opportunity to talk to you, Ken. I mean, and I know you don't do many interviews, but you anytime that you want to come on, you consider yourself a member.
Oh,
of the
thank
family.
You. Well, like I say, I always do for the military. More than happy. Just whatever they want, whatever I can do possibly for them, I'll do.
And do you have any, you want to tell everybody where they can find you on social media?
If they want? Sure, thanks. Yeah, Twitter, I'm at Ken Wahl and the number one, Ken Wahl 1. Because some dirtbag stole just my name, so I had to put Ken Wahl in a numeral after it.
That's
so
why
I
make fun of Tony's Twitter because it's like the real Tony Ganios, and I'm like, somebody's actually going around pretending.
if you look on Facebook, there's some guy. I think he's in Indonesia, and he's like dressed up like me in the Wanderers, and he's using my name.
Oh
wow.
Man!
When you talk that there's a worldwide reach with these things, you're gonna run into a few nut jobs along the way. You know,
that's
there's
true.
7.5 billion people on the world, so you're bound to run into a few wackos, right? So.
Right.
That just goes with the territory. If you open yourself up on social media, you're going to get that.
Yeah.
And I get plenty of them. So when I go and look, I saw that there was several people using Ken Wahl as their handle with different abbreviations.
Well, there's only one.
You saw on my I just didn't like using the real Ken Wahl because it takes up too many characters.
Right.
So I thought, well, I'll just do Ken Wahl and then one, the number one, and then people will get the idea.
Yeah.
So yes, you can get me on Twitter at Ken Wahl one,
right.
And then you'll see in my profile, because we're talking about heroes. The first thing I say is proud American in all uppercase letters.
Yes.
And then I say, no hero, but I played a few. So
right.
Because Vinny Terranova was a hero, the
yes.
doctor that I played, the naval doctor that I played in Purple Hearts, he was a hero. So I was happy to be able to play those heroes, to play the cop with Paul Newman in Fort Apache, he was a hero.
Yes.
So even though I'm not one myself, it's a great honor to be able to portray them as well.
Maybe by the grace of God, sometime you'll get back on the screen again, because I know everybody would love to see you. But
oh, thank you.
I got to say, before I let you go, and the one scene is my favorite, is with you and Ray Sharkey at the end when you were locked into that. I think it was a church or some kind of bar or something, and they you put the jukebox on and they play Knights in White Satin.
It's a movie theater.
Movie theater.
The lobby of a movie theater.
Yeah.
Yes, where we got locked in and we had to fight each other and all that before Sonny Steelgrave, his character, electrocutes himself.
Yeah, actually got brought to tears from that. I was the most intense scene in a movie because the lyrics of Knights in White Satin and they're staring
yeah.
at each other. And I think that
yeah.
that song actually got cut out.
That's right. Well, that's one of the problems we had with the music rights. We couldn't use that. There was another episode where I played my own father that was shot in black and white. And
yes.
Luckily,
that was the best episode. I love that.
Yeah.
And there's a song in there by Brooke Benton called It's Just a Matter of Time. And it worked so perfectly. And that was the end of that episode as well. And it worked so perfectly, but they had to take that out too and just put in generic scoring music. Because we couldn't get the rights to the songs anymore. So that's a real disappointment. And I apologize to everyone who has bought the Wise Guys CDs, not CDs, DVDs and Blu-rays. I apologize, but I have no control over that.
Yeah.
The production company could not get the rights for the music. And that's the biggest complaint that I've heard is about that Knights in White Satin scene.
Yeah.
Because, that was... And credit for that goes to David Burke, who was the head writer of Wise Guys. So I just wanted to throw his name out
Absolutely.
There. Because he's the one that picked that song, Knights of White Satin, for that scene.
Yeah.
And it was a brilliant choice, and it played beautifully, as you said.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, we just couldn't renew the rights for it, so we had to go bye-bye.
Dave, before he goes, you have a question for
Ken? More of a statement. I just want to say, Ken, what you do for all the veterans out there, that does make you a hero, so thank you.
Thank you. I disagree with you, but thank you just the same.
As a veteran, I say that because we need all the help we can get.
Yeah.
I appreciate that.
We're actually partnering up with an organization run by a retired colonel. His name is Rob Vici. It's called vetrest.org, and it tackles the PTSD situation, and it provides counseling and stuff, so...
That's terrific, because that was one of the things that really motivated me into action was when I first heard about the suicide rate of veterans. I could not believe it. I was absolutely astounded. I was dumbstruck, because I'll never forget it. I was watching the news, and I was drinking a cup of coffee, and I heard the person say, it was a woman, I don't remember her name now, but she was a veteran advocate. And she said that there were 22 suicides per day of veterans.
Wow.
And I literally did a spit take, like you see in the movie, the coffee spraying all over the place. I said, what did she say? I thought I didn't hear her correctly. She couldn't. Did she say two or 22? And then, of course, I heard it later. It was 22 suicides per day.
Even two is too many. I don't want to hear of any.
Two per century is too many.
Yeah, exactly.
So I thought, one per century is too many. So I just started, walking in circles, I got to do something. And this was before. This was, back in 2010, 2011, because this was before I was big on Twitter, because to me, Twitter was just silly. People just gossip and just silly. So I thought, no, I'm going to use Twitter for something good. I want to do something good if I can. So I thought, I got to do something where at least I can try to reach out to people and make them aware of this so that we can do whatever we can. So that's when I got involved with animal organizations, because I know that just with my own injuries, how much animal companionship has helped me. So I thought, well, if that has helped me, maybe animal companionship and comfort animals can help these guys with PTSD. And so that's how I got those two organizations together. You know, the animals with the veterans.
Yeah, and that's we've had a great idea.
Great success with that.
And
it's amazing how much, because it's a symbiotic relationship.
Yeah.
The animal is helped by the human and vice versa. You know, the human has to take care of the animal, and the animal has that unconditional love for the human. And it means so much to me that I hope that anybody within the sound of my voice, if they are in that deep of despair, that please just reach out and try before anything else, before you do anything drastic or rash, try and see if having an animal doesn't help you.
Yeah.
Because I think it will. We've had a lot of success stories with it. And so please try that.
And you know what, Ken? God bless you and keep doing what you're doing. But in all seriousness, and I mean this, not just because you're Ken Wahl, who was like my idol growing up, as from man to man, please call on us if you ever need any help with any kind of organizations or fundraisers. Even though we're here in New Jersey, we have your back 100%. I mean that.
Oh, thank you. And I yours. Absolutely, right back at you.
Thank you.
And thank you for taking the time. I'm sorry if I was a little starstruck and, you know.
Nah, that's all right. What are you kidding? Don't worry about it. That's nothing.
You know, but like I said, you have an open invite, and we're gonna let you go. And like I said, call us if you need us. We're going to talk to Tony for a few minutes and break his balls.
Hey, thanks so much again for having me.
Thank you, Ken. Thanks for calling.
Especially to all you women out there. I love you.
All you cuteless women.
Being a heartthrob.
Yeah, Mr. Heartthrob, why don't you hang around? Let him say something, and you can break my balls in like stereo with everybody else there. So don't go away yet.
Tony, let me ask you a question. In the Wanderers movie, what was your favorite scene?
My favorite scene, honestly, you mean that I just enjoyed for the pure sake of enjoyment?
Yes. Yeah.
I like the fight on the football field at the end of the movie. That was a lot of fun.
I knew he was going to say that. Let me tell you the best scene that Tony did. I'm sorry, I have to interject here.
Wait a minute. He didn't say the best scene. He said the scene that I enjoyed.
Yeah, his favorite.
I enjoyed that scene. It was cool, man. That was a lot of fun doing that.
The scene that Perry, Tony's character, and Joey, John Friedrich's character, did right before they come to the bachelor party for Richie. And they have that scene where they're going to take off to California, and they're talking about it. And Tony was so spot on perfect in that scene, because he was still strong and powerful. I don't mean physically, I mean mentally, emotionally. Yet he was vulnerable at the same time.
Right. Yeah.
And it was such an effective scene. And then when Joey's father comes in and he fights with Perry, and Joey hits his father over the head with a bottle, and he says, and Perry says, "Look, that's your father. You got to respect that. Don't forget that." That is really what the Wanderers is about, because these guys are not just idiot teenagers.
Right.
They had a very innocent yet sincere sense of honor and nobility.
Right.
And Tony, as Perry, sum that up in that one line: "That's your father, and don't forget that. You know, you got to respect him."
Right.
Even though seconds before, the father was trying to kill Perry.
Right.
That's really what that movie is about, and that's why it has withstood the test of time all these years.
Right.
You know,
it's because that movie's got heart.
Oh,
it's not just about the fighting and the elbow tit and then all that stuff. That stuff is nice, fun, peripheral stuff.
Right.
But the core, the heart of that movie is when Perry says that to Joey.
You know what? You know what I like the dynamic of the movie. It's about teenagers in gangs. They were tough guys, but they weren't like dregs of society. They were a little family, but behind the scenes, like, you had Perry's mother, who was a drinker. Like, there was dysfunctionality there. It wasn't like the Beaver Cleaver. You know, they went home.
But it goes even beyond that. Is that these guys weren't just a street gang to be tough idiots. They felt, and Tony and I were just talking about this yesterday, they felt as though they were protectors of that neighborhood.
Right.
That it wasn't just to have a turf war, just to be, hey, I'm cool, I'm tough. It was like that was their little kingdom.
Right.
That was their whole universe.
Yes.
You know, it was just a few square blocks. That was their universe. That was their, what they called their turf,
right,
was really their universe. And they felt like protectors of that. And they were very, although very innocent and even naive, but yet it had a tremendous nobility to it, a tremendous dignity to it.
Yeah.
And that was the subtext of it. And that what's the beauty of that movie, in my eyes.
Anyway. Right. I agree.
I grew up in Newark, New Jersey, and it was the same way. Like, everybody in the neighborhood, you know, looked out for one another. You could leave your front door open, and you didn't have to worry.
That's right.
You know?
And I grew up on the south side of Chicago, and it was the same thing there.
Right.
And I'm sure in every major urban area, Detroit, Cleveland, you name it, Philadelphia, any place, St. Louis, Milwaukee, all of those places are like that,
right,
especially back then.
Oh yeah,
it's not like that now.
Kenny, did you grow up in the Kenny? Did you grow up in the Patch?
No.
No. Okay.
No, I grew up in West Englewood, and you can look that up now. That is the murder capital of America, West Englewood.
Oh,
the West Englewood neighborhood of Chicago.
We got out just in time.
Around 63rd Street, 63rd and Damon, is where I started out, and right now, it's the murder capital of America.
Oh, wow.
We're number one. We're number one.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
Now, what about...
What was that? You cut out. I missed that. What was that?
No.
I said, we're number one. We're number one.
Yeah, right. We're number one. Yeah. How proud I must be.
Kenny, did you have a favorite episode of Wise Guy that really hit home for you?
Who are you talking to?
Kenny.
Yes, absolutely. The black and white one where I got to play Vinny and Vinny's father.
That's my favorite, too.
Dual role, and I won the Golden Globe Award for Best Actor for that. And I'm most proud of it, not just for the award, but because talk about battles with the network. Oh, my God. Everything was a battle. They didn't want to do the show in the first place. They didn't want to do it in black and white. We did it a hybrid, which I thought was one of my best ideas, because we filmed the present day stuff in color.
Right.
And when Vinny was reading his father's diary of the past, we filmed the scenes from the past in black and white.
Right.
And that turned out to be really effective. And the network fought me tooth and nail all the way through that show in filming it. And guess what happened? Not only did I win the Golden Globe for it, it turned out to be our highest rated episode ever.
Oh, wow.
So that was satisfying to me on many levels.
Shows you how much the executives know.
Yeah.
Well, you know what it is? It's, you're dealing with these mid-level executives
right.
that are trying to justify their position.
Right.
So they have to make their authority known.
Right.
And in doing so, they almost invariably will screw things up. So you just got to keep fighting them and just say, look, we're going to do it this way. The advantage I had in this instance, was that we filmed the show in Vancouver. And because the suits down in L.A. really couldn't intervene, it's like, okay, what are you going to do? Are you going to fire me in the middle of the show? We're going to do it in black and white, whether you mid-level guys like it or not. Because in a few weeks, that mid-level guy is going to be fired anyway.
Right.
He's not even going to be there anymore.
Yeah.
So what you do is you basically just say, okay, and just agree with them, and then go off and do what you want anyway. That way it just saves a lot of time and aggravation.
But for a show like that, for the authenticity, why didn't they do it in like a New York or New Jersey setting?
Ooh. Just look in your pocket.
Yeah.
Money. Purely money. That's the only reason. Look, at that time, the exchange rate for the dollar from the Canadian to the American dollar was something like 71 cents. So you're getting a 29% discount right off the top. So I can't blame Cannell for wanting to do. Plus, it's on the West Coast, so right? So L.A.'s down there. So you're on the same time zone, even though it's still 1,000 miles away. But you are in the same time zone. So people can communicate with each other back and forth. That wasn't a problem.
Uh-huh.
But for a 29% break right off the top, just as a businessman, I don't blame them for doing that. But, yeah, as far as the artistic part goes, for authenticity, sure, we would have loved to have filmed it in AC, in Atlantic City, and Brooklyn, where Vinny was from. It's just cost prohibitive. It's just too damn much money.
Yeah.
But we did go to Washington, D.C. Another fight I had with the network to get some, they had to pony up some more money for the license fee so that we could go film in Washington, D.C. Because I said by the third season, and we were so well established, and so our ratings increased every season.
Right.
But still, even though they were increasing, they weren't gargantuan ratings. But we were so well respected that I said, come on, we got to do at least, we got to get out of Vancouver at least for one storyline. So we finally did and went to Washington, D.C. for about 10 days.
Well, it worked. That's all I could say. And I watch it every time it's on. And I have all the, you know, I was lucky to get the shows that haven't aired.
Thank you, man, because I need those 47-cent residual checks. So keep on watching, brother. Keep on watching.
I will. Thank you so much. Ken Wahl, everybody.
Yeah.
Good talking to you, Ken.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks again so much for having me. God bless you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so
much. Thank you.
You're very welcome. You take care.
Take care. Tony,
bye-bye.
You there?
Yes.
Tony, listen to me. You know I break your balls, and I love you, brother. Thank you so much for making this happen for us tonight.
Oh, that's really cool. That was a really good interview you guys gave.
Yeah, my
buddy.
Yeah, a lot of fun. Yeah.
That was a really good interview, Carlo.
So when you come to Jersey, Tony?
Yeah, when you gonna come? I want to cook.
I don't know. The last time last time I was in Jersey was a couple of years ago. But before that, I think last time I was there, I was a little kid. Yeah, I had an aunt. I had an aunt in Egg Harbor, wherever.
Yeah, that's not far.
That's
not far at all.
Yeah, it's by Atlantic City. Yeah.
Yeah, I had an aunt there. I remember going there when I was a little kid. But
she's still there?
No. It was a long time. She's in
witness protection.
Like that. I remember going there.
She's in witness protection now. No, she's not there.
I heard she owns a yogurt.
No. I think she's. I think she's taking a dirt nap now.
Oh.
It wasn't my aunt. It was my mother's aunt.
So
she's a great aunt.
She's a gardener.
She's pushing up daisies, man.
Yeah. So. I heard she owned a yogurt business.
She's a florist.
Yeah, she owns a yogurt business.
Angora with the yogurt. You know, what is it with you guys with that? What is it with the yogurt? You guys are sick on that.
I think he really wants you to come to Jersey and
I got
his
a kick
car
out of that story, and I like break. You know, I break your balls when we talk on the phone.
No, I know. But the yogurt, you guys have a fixation on yogurt, man.
I don't know why.
I was hungry. I was sitting in a parking lot, and you know, these guys. You know, there was a supermarket there. That's all I could get. That I could eat with a spoon, you know, while we were waiting.
Oh, but see, I took it as Cyril was breaking your balls because you were trying to eat healthy, and they didn't expect that.
I could have just as easily gone in there and got some raw chopped meat and eaten it out of the package. I would do that too, but they didn't have it in the store, you know. And then they could have. Well, I don't know what they would have done. Now.
So from now on, you don't say cottage cheese anymore, Carlo. It's yogurt.
All right, I stand.
I'm trying to remember now. Now you know what? Now I mixed up myself. Now I don't remember from the bullshit. I don't know what we. There's a video on YouTube where Cyril's telling the story, and I don't remember.
Yeah, it's
the opposite.
Yeah, I could have sworn
that's
he said
that's
maybe
what
that's,
I remember.
Maybe I got it wrong from him, but you know, but
fake news. No,
I I hope you. Listen, I'm sorry I didn't get it. You know, get you much airtime, but you're.
No, hey, listen, I already did you guys' show, man. I'm really happy you guys you got the.
Do you think
got
he
my
was
buddy
happy
on
with
he
the
has really good stuff to say, you know?
Tony, do you think he was happy with the way it went?
No, he hated it.
Yeah, I do. Yeah. I do. I think he was happy. I think he had fun. That's my personal opinion of what happened.
Thank you all for listening, and we'll see you all next week. I hope you enjoyed the show. This is the Animal House Radio Show.
Good night, everybody.
Good night.